If you'd like to download my presentation, it is available on this URL. Actually, I also uploaded the Linux Foundation website, but I couldn't find my slide. I don't know why. Okay. So, yeah. You can download from this one. Okay. So, can I start it? Okay. Thanks for coming to my presentations. I'm Yoshitake Kobayashi from Toshiba, and my presentation title is an essential relationship between real-time and resource partitioning. Before just starting the presentation, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm working at Toshiba as a chief specialist. I don't know what it's that, but yeah, I also managing a Linux team at Toshiba, and my team providing embedded operating system technologies and knowledges for all Toshiba products, and that includes not only Linux but also the other real-time operating systems and also open source software license issues, like a compliance issue. Yeah, we need to provide such kind of knowledge in Toshiba. So, this is my presentation overview. At first, I'd like to explain background, why I interested in this topic. And then, there are three requirements. I'd like to explain that kind of detail of each requirement. And after that, I'd like to define what hardware resource partitioning is. Then I had some implementations and also evaluation we did. And at the last, I summarized my presentation. At first is a background. There are two point of view. One is hardware. The other one is software. And if I look the current hardwares, there are many kinds of multi-core CPUs available now. And also, if we want to use such kind of multi-core CPU on embedded system, it is easier than before. And also, we can use a lot of memories, because it used to be we have to use only maybe few hundred kilobytes of memory on embedded system. But nowadays, we can use about more than 512 megabyte memories on the embedded systems. So, but and also if we when we look at from the software view, we can use, of course, we can use Linux, and Linux have many kind of features that we can use easy for the embedded systems. For example, power management systems and memory, and also the real-time things like that. Okay, I explained about the virtualization virtual machine monitor, but some embedded system try to use this kind of stuff, but my presentation doesn't focus it. So, if I focus to the real-time systems, there are performance requirement issue. This is a very big problems to when we implemented something on the with Linux. The first requirement is, of course, real-time things. And all real-time application should meet its real-time constraint. But we have many variety of the products, and every product have different requirement for the real-time constraint. So, but. Commonly, we need to think about the deadline. If we try to meet the deadline, we need to think also about when the system can be response This event response type is longer than expected. We only have maybe few times by spans in that. In that case, we cannot meet the deadline. So we need to think about both of them. And for the event, for response time, is we have from 100 microseconds to hundreds microseconds. And also, to meet this deadline, we need to have 10 microseconds event response time in some case. So the requirement two is a system need to be able to run both real-time application and general purpose applications at same hardware. This is a new requirement for us because nowadays we can use multi-core CPU, and someone thinking, okay, now we have two cores, and I would like to use one core for real-time systems, and the other one core, maybe we can use general purpose. So this is a requirement. But to do so, this is really, really difficult. I will explain it later. So, but now we have some implementations, and to make a real-time world and a general-purpose world on the system, we prepare two hardwares and implement RT application on specific hardware, and the other hardware implemented general-purpose applications on that. And if real-time application and general-purpose application need to be connected, we connect by bus, or we just use a shared memory. Yeah, this is a quite a specific. We need specific hardware to provide shared memory on one board, but it has two CPUs like that. Yeah, this is a current implementation, but actually, we would like to make a simple world, and that means only one hardware able to control real-time and general-purpose applications. So when I say system software can control both of them, that kind of software is operating systems or virtual machine monitors. So to implement this kind of world, there are two approaches. One approach is hybrid OS approach, and the other one is single OS approach. And at first, I'd like to explain the hybrid OS approach. When we implemented a hybrid OS, there are two or more operating systems running on the same hardware platform. And one for real-time specific tasks runs on the real-time OS. And the other task, for example, the general-purpose task, runs on the general-purpose operating systems. And current implementation, we use a Microtron, and this is a very popular operating system in Japan. We use a Microtron for the real-time OS, and Linux for the general-purpose operating systems. The other possible implementations, we use a virtual machine monitor to run these two operating systems. And the other option is real-time OS and general-purpose OS. If we use this kind of operating systems, we need to use different APIs on the real-time OS and general purpose operating systems. I think this is a problem. So I'd like to explain about DinoMai. DinoMai is a dual kernel approach based on the Adios and IPath. And IPipe works to catch the interrupt and then allocate it, schedule it to the real-time world and general purpose world. And DinoMai can be implemented as skins and as much as you like. And there are many kinds of skins already available from the MicroIton to VxWorks. This is a kind of a real-time operating system, APRs. So the other one is, the other hybrid architecture is SafeG. SafeG is a research project that's doing the Japanese university. And they use ARM architecture, and especially for the ARM Trust Zone architecture for that. Yeah, ARM Trust Zone architecture able to isolate the trusted world and non-trusted world. And real-time, in that case, real-time OS running on the trusted world, then that operating systems only use FIQ devices, fast IRQ devices. And general purpose operating systems use IRQ devices. And this is what they can. But of course, this is architecture dependent, because we need to use ARM for that. The other approach is a single operating system approach. In this approach, we just use one operating system to run the both real-time application and general purpose applications. In that case, the biggest advantage is we can use same API to implement it both applications. And that's what we want. So if we use if we want to use such kind of implementations with Linux, we can use a real-time preemption patch for that to improve the real-time performance. So this is what we want, but this actually goes to this world. So in that time, I'd like to summary of the requirements. We have three requirements. First one is run a real-time process and general purpose process on a hardware platform. And also, and second requirement is our real-time application has to need to meet a required deadline. So this is one of the most important issues. And the last requirement, we need to use Linux on that. This is looks like quite simple, but I think this is not a good idea if you doesn't care anything about real-time things. That's why I had this presentation in here. Yeah, because I can say this box you can use for controlling systems. You can control something, but after that, some customer asked me, "Oh, what happened? This system just stopped." And then I asked, "What you did?" "I would like to plug in my USB memory stick on it." In such kind of case, USB memory sticks is a big problem for the real-time systems. If you try to evaluate such kind of things, you we'll get a serious problem for the interrupt latency response time. So the reason why I think so is a real-time system should have a deterministic behavior, but usually user doesn't have a deterministic behavior. For example, if we use a computer, the keyboard timing is not deterministic, and also memory stick, we don't assume when the memory stick is plugged in. So general purpose process doesn't assume a deterministic behavior. This is most biggest issues for that. So in that case, you need to think how to improve real-time performance on these configurations. I said we can use a real-time preemption patch, and that patch makes the Linux kernel as a free preemptive kernel to reduce the event response time. So, and also Linux kernel has a CPU affinity features. That's features prohibit process migration from one core to another. So that means, okay, this kind of process group need to run core zero, and the other one just go run the other cores. I can say that. So if this is possible, we can say, okay, this core can be used only real-time processes, and the other core doesn't affect anything about that. And this approach may be good for determinism for the real-time processes. But so in that case, I'd like to define what hardware resource partitioning is. When I call the partition, this is a set of the hardware resources, like a CPU core and device and memory, things like that. And each partition must be isolated from the others. So that means no device sharing. So real-time process only use this device set, but the other process can be used the other one. Yeah, things like that. We need to do this assumption for that, because otherwise it is really, really complicated to make this kind of world. So this is what hardware partitioning is. And when we try to create this kind of world, we use CPU affinity features in the Linux kernel. So this feature able to run a set of process only runs on the specific CPU thread and CPU core. And the advantage is no process migration occurs from the cores to the another. So, and also I can say just real-time process runs on the specific core. So this is some kind of isolation from the between the cores. But when we evaluate this CPU affinity with some workload, of course, when we try to run a real-time application and general-purpose application without CPU affinity feature, the event response time becomes big. But when we try to run this kind of application with CPU affinity, the result looks really nice. So we did this kind of evaluation with a Panda board, because a Panda board has a dual core CPU, yeah, with a 3.6 kernel real time with a preemption patch. And this is a 300 microsecond is a period. So that this is a deadline for that. But Okay. In some cases, I got this result with CPU affinity. Yeah. Without CPU affinity, the worst one is 440. But this is around 1000 microseconds. So this is very rare case. For example, maybe I got this result every 1 hour or something like that. So, and then we try to find what is the problem on CPU affinity. And this is the results with this case. Oh, sorry, this case. So what happens in here is timer cascading occurs. I will explain what timer cascade is later. So there are a big limitation with CPU affinity. Yeah, some kernel thread cannot be migrated from one to another, even it provide a service to the general purpose applications. Yeah, this is a very big limitation for that. And there are many kernel threads cannot be migrated from a timer and high resolution timer and process migration and work queue. So this is what we doesn't expect it with CPU affinity. So, and then we try to find out what cascade timer doing. And cascade timer is the resistor using to resist the timers to the this kind of list. So, and this timer list has to be managed every timer's expiration. Yeah, I can show what's happening in kernel. Can you read the source code? Okay. This part is a problem. So this cascade, many of cascade runs at a time. If there are lots of timers has registered, these lines takes a long time to process it. And unfortunately, this cascade process runs with interrupt disabled context. That means cannot preempt. So that's why that problem was occurs. And also, we can register as much as we want to the timer event. So this is also the problem for this issue. And so, to control the cascade timer, we start to control this kind of stuff on real-time CPU core. That most important solution is just keep the timer, this kind of list on the real-time core is empty. Yeah, so if this list is empty, no cascade occurs. But only we need is timers for the real-time tasks. So the real-time task related timer need to run on this one, but the other one has to go to the other core. That's what we need to do. And there are three issues which cause the cascading timers. And first one is if a kernel thread can be migrated to the another core, but this thread has already registered some timers on the list. This is the first one. And second one is this core specific kernel thread just register timer. But this timer doesn't relate it on the real-time things. And the third one is some of the timers have registered before real-time task runs. So the difference between 2 and 3 is a bit difficult to explain. Maybe next slide is better. The next slide is better. Okay. So solution for the issue 1 is we need to prepare a log space in the kernel, and to get a log for all timer registrations. So if we have this kind of log, we can use migrating timer from real-time core to general purpose core. When at first we need to migrate kernel thread itself to the general purpose core, then the related timer also migrate to this core based on this log. So this log which timer is related to the which kernel thread. So that's why we can use like that. This is a timer migration. And the solution for the issues 2 and 3 doing like this. And when solution 2 is like that. If core-specific time kernel thread need to work some general purpose process before moving that, some processes, we need to restrict to register new timers on the real-time core, and it goes to general purpose core only. So this is a solution for 2. And the other solution for 3 is if there are some timers already registered, but it is not enough time to migrate, in that case, we need to wait. But after that, we may have enough time to migrate. In that case, we can migrate the timer to general purpose core. This is the solution for the issues 2 and 3, and what we did like that. And after we did this kind of implementations, we evaluated the real-time latency. And before the these implementations, the timer cascading occurs on the same core, but after the implementations, all timers goes to the general purpose core, and only occurs the timer cascading on the different core. So this is what we did. So. To implement it like that, we define the real-time CPU here, and then cascade. This is Emacs. Okay. We try to. We try to migrate the old timers. just look at the timer events for the cascading timer list, and then if we need to migrate it, it can be migrated. If you want, I can give you dispatch, but I know dispatch is not fixed yet because there are lots of problems on it. If we use dispatch, we cannot run. We cannot run new real-time applications after using that. This is the biggest problem, and why I didn't post the patch to the LKML. So sorry for that. This is a summary of my presentations. There are three requirements for this, and real-time process. We need to learn real-time process and general-purpose process on the one hardware, and we want to use Linux only. We don't want to use the other operating systems on the same hardware, and real-time systems real-time process must meet its required deadline. So this is a requirement, and we use a hardware resource partitioning to solve this case. And the hardware partitioning is a set of hardware resources, and we also define the cores, one for real-time core, the other one for general-purpose core. But there are big issues when we use CPU affinity, and we did some study on it. Currently, just a study because not fixed yet. And future plan is we need to fix many bugs. And also, we would like to use a skate deadline on RT core with fine granularity support. Fine granularity means we need to have microseconds orders. Yeah, but the current implementation only supports 1 millisecond order. But skate deadline is also a quite nice feature for us because we can isolate it between the real-time CPUs, and we can say on this process needs to this time, and this process needs to this time. We can define like that. This is a nice feature for that. This is all my question. This is all my presentation. And thanks for listening. And any questions? Yeah, please.
Did you assign affinity of the interrupt also?
IRQ interrupt? Yeah, we did that.
Okay, and what about the use case applications, you know, the server, client server applications, general purpose? Spawning threads, processes. On the fly, you have to patch the user space, right? So they run on specific cores.
I see. General purpose process, no. We
Okay.
Please.
The question is why not to define a special real time timer event and just compile a timer from a real time core down to this core, and all other timers that just spawn the general purpose timers are spread over other cores. And you don't have to migrate. Okay. Can migrate, for instance, you spawn a general purpose timer or it is migrated to another core, which may distribute the timer over other cores, but to issue a hazard on a single core where you have a single core processing its own timers plus the timers coming from real time.
Of course,
you just need to define a real time timer.
You mean just we need to define real time timer and general purpose timer, with things and things like that.
Yeah,
I see.
Here but you know, because here you
all the timers.
Or you have to specify what timers you want to migrate, because I assume sometimes you want to run on the same real-time core.
Yeah. The timer just goes related to the specific process. So that's why we can say this timer is on real-time core and the other one for general purpose core. This is why. But the user, when we use ICE CPU, the only real-time process runs on the real-time CPU core. I can say, okay, maybe we don't need migrate from the real-time core to another. But in that case, we didn't expect this kind of things. Yeah, we just start whenever we want. To isolate the timer and to isolate the real-time stuff and general purpose stuff. That's why we need to use this kind of approach. So, but I think you can your idea also we need to think about that.
Yeah.
But core-specific kernel thread cannot be migrated. So if the timer only goes to the related to the some core-specific kernel thread, we can't migrate that thread. Only need to migrate the timer to the other one.
But which core-specific kernel threads generate timers on the fly? Usually, the kernel-specific core-specific kernel threads have also core-specific tasks. And they don't run if you don't, as interspace applications, stress them.
I see.
So I cannot really follow it right now, but really the problem is that you have core-specific kernel timer threads running there.
If you have the outbound workers.
But the worker threads also work for the workload you generate locally and not remotely. There's no localizing behind this.
The outbound ones could end up anywhere, right?
But you can't combine them as well. One thing I would suggest basically is to describe your problem on the main list and get a discussion on this. Because these kind of changes, they break all the time.
Yeah,
if you do this locally and you run into troubles, obviously, that you generated an unstable system this way, this falls apart easily. On the other hand, there is work going on in this direction, as you know. Config no HZ topics, so we would run 100% fast on one core. So the requirements are there in the community, they're available. And any quirk, any effect you observe in your system is probably well received there. You describe it properly and then see what suggestions come from there. So this kind of local solution
I think so. This is very tricky. Yeah.
Speaking with the one that created the structure, you kind of work with why
maybe there's something going wrong, or
maybe there's something wrong before that.
I see. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, maybe so. Okay. I see. Only cascading release.
Cascading, you just
on the purpose of the core.
I see.
You can just design on the other core, but the timers themselves run on the original core.
I see.
The core.
Okay.
To preserve habit.
I see. Okay. Thank you, Bear. And the other questions? Thanks for joining. Yeah. Thank you very much.